Hey everyone, I'm Mark.
I'm Ian.
And this is the Uncaped Crusaders review. This week's episode, we're going to be reviewing the animated film Under the Red Hood from 2010. And that was really the renaissance of this whole wave of animated movies we've had since then.
Yeah, it kind of started, you know, the ability to show people all the great Batman storylines that, you know, if you don't read the comics, you don't know about. So they figured out, I guess, this movie was a good way to kind of show people that. Obviously, they're, you know, storylines, Dark Knight Returns, Killing Joke, Year One, aren't going to be in feature films. So they're like, hey, if we do an anime movie, make it PG-13, people take it seriously. And yeah, the good ones they do.
It's real memorable to me, and I liked it immediately when it came out. I thought it was really good.
Yeah, and it's such a, you know, beloved, you know, comic book story, you know, graphic novel that, you know, we're already familiar with that. So, yeah, the movie comes out, of course, it's a big deal.
Well, and I hadn't even read the story first. Like, when it came out, I didn't even really know much about the original comic. So it was kind of an introduction to me of that whole storyline and character. But sometimes I feel like it's better to come in that way because it's nice going in knowing everything. But it's also nice sometimes not knowing everything because then you don't get mad at the stuff that maybe deviates from it or disappointed. It's just the movie for you. And then when you go read the book's almost always better. So then you can be like, oh, this is better. This has this, this, this. But you don't hold it against the movie because you saw the movie first.
Yeah, I always like seeing the movie first and then reading afterward. But, I mean, we'll talk more about how I feel about the movie and stuff when we get into it. But, yeah, actually, in this case, and I'll mention later, it's actually better to not know before watching the movie because there's such a big twist, you know, the big moment in the movie. I envy people who haven't read about it or heard about it, but we'll talk more about that.
Yeah. So, like we said, Batman animated movie, it was really kind of the first trend towards this PG-13. Obviously, the first one was Return of the Joker, which kind of broke that mold. But this one really exploited that, I think, for the first time. This movie is not for kids in any way, shape, or form. It's a fully adult comic book fan movie. It fully adheres to all of the violence and stuff of the original comic storyline. Overall, it's definitely... It's a shock if you hadn't seen... If you'd only seen, like, Batman cartoon shows and stuff until this, it definitely would be a shock as far as... animation goes.
Oh, sure. I mean, there's blood in the movie, but I think overall the reason why it's a little bit more mature is actually just the story itself and like the themes it deals with. And we'll talk more about it, but that's why actually I like this the story so much. It's actually one of Batman's darker stories without there being like a whole lot of, I mean, not a whole lot of people die really, but still, like, you know, it is basically one of his big failures kind of. And but yeah, we'll talk more about that.
Yeah. All right. So basically, movie starts and it's we're basically seeing the finale of Death of the Family, or Death in the Family. I have both of those now. I always get them wrong. And Death in the Family, where Joker has Robin, aka Jason Todd, in a warehouse strapped up, and he's just beating him to death with a crowbar.
Yeah.
You know. Very similar from the book. Obviously, it's different because, you know, Jason Todd's mom isn't there. It's not in Iran or wherever he was. It's not any part in connected with that story except for the actual scene of him beating him with the crowbar. And, you know, Joker's taunting him, typical Joker fashion. Beat him up. It's great. John DiMaggio's voice of the Joker. I think we've talked about another episode. It's not my favorite. I don't really like it. It's very deep, very low. Very different than almost any other voices. I feel like I've really done it.
Okay, kiddo, I gotta go. It's been fun though, right? Well, maybe a smidge more fun for me than you. I'm just guessing since you're being awful quiet. Anyway, be a good boy, finish your homework, and be in bed by 9. And hey, please tell the big man I said hello.
Ha 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 ha!
but it's not like it doesn't take you out of it. It's not like that distracting or annoying. It's just different, and I'm not as big of a fan of it. I'm more of a fan of the higher pitched Joker voices. It's definitely more menacing, though.
Yeah, Parker. I mean, what helps all his lines are still classic Joker. But yeah, the voice, yeah, just is a favorite for me because it's so like kind of soft spoken and natural. You don't normally associate that with Joker. It's always being like kind of high pitched. Keith Ledger or had to talk Mark Hamill, but then also like growling, like make the Joker gets angry. And so to have this kind of well spoken and kind of soft voice, especially in the scene where he's talking about like Black Mask, you know, when he busting out of jail, and just kind of talking very monotone voice you don't normally associate with Joker. So that's kind of weird, but it's still not off putting.
Yeah. And he still has the laugh in there, the high pitched laugh and stuff. So, you know. It definitely gets the menacing part across a little bit more, sure. So it's fine. Then Joker leaves, and then in between it cuts to Ra's al Ghul at his palace talking about, you know, he has the boy, and, you know, Batman basically is not, he's saying Batman's not going to get there in time. Then you see Batman on the bat cycle racing towards the warehouse, intercut with Joker beating up Robin, and then Joker finally leaves. Robin, like, tries to stand up, can't stand up. His legs, I'm sure, are broken at this point. And he's dragging himself across the floor with just, like, blood, like, pooling out underneath him. And then gets to the door, and, of course, it's locked. So then he just kind of sits there, and then he sees the bomb that's about to go off. And then Batman's, like, almost getting there, and then, boom. Yeah, building explodes, just like from the original story. And then, you know, Batman rushes into the rubble and, you know, finds the body of dead Jason Todd, which is my biggest pet peeve of the entire movie. Well, no, I take it back. There's one more pet peeve I have. That's more. One thing I hate more. But this, okay, he was just in this giant explosion after being beat up, and his costume is completely intact. There's not a single rip or tear in it at all.
Yeah.
Why?
I mean, normally you would say, you know, because they don't want to make it too graphic, but then the rest of the movie, you have
they blow a dude's head off. Like, that can't be the reason. That's why it annoys me.
That part, I don't get really. But at least there's no, like, trickery. There's no, like, you know, last-minute cut before explosion. Like, he finds his body, and he's confirmed dead, you know.
Yeah.
There's no, like, oh, maybe. It's like, nope, in this scene, yeah, he's dead.
And that's
he should look like, you know, hamburger, but obviously they're not going to do that.
Even in the comic, he's all torn up in the shot of Batman holding him. But whatever. Just minor complaint. But that's the intro. What an awesome intro. It's got to be like one of the best intros.
Yeah.
Anyway, so then the movie starts, and there's all these mob bosses gathered in a warehouse of some kind.
Yeah, they all got called, but they all know who called them.
Yeah, they keep asking, oh, did you call this? I'm like, no, I thought you did. And all of a sudden, you just hear, you know, then there's the Red Hood above, like, shooting down at them with an AK-47. And it's basically saying, like, you guys are going to work for me now, and you're going to kick up, like, I think 40% or something of everything you get to me. you know, this is better than what Black Mask is giving you. And basically, they're going to defect from Black Mask to be now under Red Hood. And then he throws down a duffel bag and is like, those are the heads of all your lieutenants. And he's like, and I did that in 2 hours. It's like, imagine what I could do in a whole day. At first, they're all mad and stuff before he even throws the head down. And they're like, you know, you're basically dead. What do you think you're doing? Crossing us like this, like, there's easier ways to kill yourself. And he's like, yeah, like yelling at the guy with the AK-47. Just great. You just see no fear whatsoever, just fully in charge of the situation. And basically they agree, one, because they don't really have a choice, and two, because they don't really have a choice. So that's like our introduction to the Red Hood. So then we have Batman engaged in a car chase with these guys on a dock, I guess, stock
shipping.
Yeah, like shipping yard or something like that. And he's chasing down. They had stolen some crate, and he basically it like falls out of the truck, and he stops the truck, and then it somehow gets activated and opens, and then it's this like giant robot like that has superpowers basically.
Yeah,
just kind of.
Yeah, that part I don't like is that you know, obviously it's a robot. They explain it later, but it doesn't look like a robot. It looks straight, you know, like a Superman film. There's like a elf-looking mutant. Like, he's huge. Yeah. He's got like green spandex on. Like, I don't know if you refer to just like normal-looking, like cyborg, you know, like something crazy-looking. But yeah, I thought that it didn't quite fit like the rest of the movie. You know, feels like very grand, like noir. You know.
It really seemed like it was just in there to have, like, an action scene with a big...
I totally get that, but, like, just to look at, like, Amazo's, like, you know, and Batman's like, oh, I know what that is. Like, are you sure you didn't, you know, he's not supposed to be a Green Lantern or Superman, but...
Right. So, anyways, they're acting like they have no idea what they were... they didn't know what they were doing or anything. So then he leaves them and has to fight this thing now, which is attacking him. And then Nightwing shows up. Mm-hmm. Which is voiced by Neil Patrick Harris, which is just off-putting the whole time. You're just like, I feel like I should be laughing like every time he speaks, but he's not saying anything funny. But it's Neil Patrick Harris.
Yeah, because his voice is so recognizable. It's like, I look like, you know, some lesser actor, but it's still fun.
Yeah, and the voice of Batman for this is Bruce Greenwood, who's, I guess, recently most popular for being the commander in the new Star Trek movies.
Star Trek, yeah. Admiral Pike.
Yeah, the Admiral, yeah. So, and I think he does a good job. You know, for not having Kevin Conroy, he's probably my next favorite.
For being like a first timer too,
yeah. I like him. He's done a couple of them, I think. I think he might have done like...
Oh, really?
Yeah, I think he's done... I think he's been the voice of most of the animated movies recently. Because Kevin Conroy hasn't been doing a lot of them. So, anyway. But, so they're basically fighting this Amazo, and that's really it. They're just fighting. Then all of a sudden it's like, oh, it can fly. And then it's like, oh, it has laser eyes. And you basically have Nightwing narrating everything to you. I figured that out in this movie. Literally, Nightwing narrates everything for you.
Yeah.
Like, literally everything. Like, later on, they're, like, talking about, like, how the Red Hood, like, cut Batman's rope or whatever, and he's literally, like, explaining it and play-by-play to Batman, like, on the screen. Like, see, look at that. He cut it right there before the rope, like, like tightened up. And it's like, okay, well, clearly Batman knows this and already recognizes it. So who are you talking to?
I guess the audience.
No, whatever. It's fine. So they fight it, and then eventually Batman like puts like plastic in its eyes, and it, while trying to blast him off, blows it up, and it blows its head off. So then they have all the three guys, which we kind of talked about earlier, and are trying to get them to talk, which is another stupid, the whole scene is stupid. They have the Amazo on like a lift or something, or like dropping it to where it's like hanging over top of it. And for some reason that makes them talk.
Like the blood or oil gets on them and they freak out. Yeah,
I don't really get how that makes them talk, but it does. And then they're like, no, we work for the Red Hood, you know. That's the first time we ever hear the name Red Hood.
First time Batman is too.
Yeah, first time Batman hears about it. And then like right when they're about to keep talking, all of a sudden they get sniped, all three of them. And then, you know, Batman uses something, binoculars, to see however forever away.
A whole skyline. He
can zoom right into his face, and it's, you know, the Red Hood on a building 40 miles away, and then he gets on the bat, you know, the bat wing, and chases after him. That's a pretty cool chase scene with him chasing Red Hood over the rooftops. Red Hood gets in a car, and then he's chasing the car, and eventually chases it into the Axis chemical plant. And, you know, where the Joker was created. And Red Hood is standing there and is like, you know, you recognize this place, like the sign of like your first and greatest failure. And then he blows it up, and Batman gets out, and he gets away, and then in the explosion.
They go back to the Batcave, and they're talking about it briefly. And I think, like, you know, they're mentioning, like, you know, he knows about the Joker and stuff like that.
And, like, he's wearing the Red Hood, which, you know, the Joker form. Yeah, they talk about how many people had been the Red Hood.
Right.
One of them, obviously, being the Joker. And so then they're, like, now they sense a connection between the Joker, so they go to Arkham to visit him. And, you know, he's fully in Arkham. And basically he's, like, and they have to shove that down your throat again about Jason Todd, because he says a line like, oh, well, he's better off than the other one. And it's like,
yeah,
okay, well, whatever. And then he's like, basically Joker's like, you think I'd go through all this trouble and not make you sure that, you know, it was me? And so then they leave and
yeah. All the basically Black Mask is pissed off because Red Hood is kind of isolating him, taking all his business, taking all his partners, so Black Mask is pissed and beating up his own guys and whatnot. And I think that's when they show that Red Hood has like a bug in his office. So Batman. I think they talk about the shipment of weapons that's coming in. So they kind of set up the next run-in with the Red Hood. Next, Black Mask getting shipment full of weapons. He's ensured that nothing will go wrong. And then so we kind of cut to that.
Yeah. Basically, like, a helicopter's coming in with shipments, and it lands of guns and ammunition and stuff. And then it's supposed to, like, be this quick thing, and basically then it's the Red Hood who, you know, because of the bug, knew it was there. And
hijacks the helicopter.
Yeah, yeah, and starts, like, take it down. And then Batman shows up with Nightwing, and basically he disables the helicopter, and it starts to crash. And then I guess he stops it from landing on the ground, like with cables or something. And then Red Hood gets out and starts this really cool, like, rooftop chase. Might be my best. That might be the best scene of the movie. It was.
I agree. It was a really good foot chase, like, because they're going, like, you know, along buildings, and they're just basically trying to keep up with Red Hood. And the whole time they're talking about how, like, good he is, and, like, you know, Nightwing's commenting on how fast he is and stuff like that. And yeah, it's actually a really good chase.
Yeah, they're going, like, across rooftops, across, like, scaffolding from, like, you know, buildings being built and all this stuff. Just doing all these really cool moves. And then, like, about halfway through, Batman starts to record it through his, like, cowl or whatever. And then they're about to get him, and Batman, like, throws, like, a batarang on a bat rope. And then, like, but before, you know, he can, like, yank it back, like, Red Hood, like, cuts it with a knife, and then
midair, he ropes his ankle before it can, you know, catch him. He turns around and cuts the knife in midair. It's pretty impressive.
Yeah, it's a cool move. And then and then they have him, like, at the edge where they think they have him, but then he, like, jumps out and grabs some other rope that's hanging off, like, I don't know, a crane or something. And then, you know, like, crashes through, I guess it's a train station.
Or a terminal, above ground terminal.
Yeah. And crashed through there, and then they follow him. But then as soon as they, like, get down there, he had planted a bomb that, like, goes off and stuns them, and then the train's, like, coming.
I think that's what, like, hurts Nightwing. Like, it hurts his leg, I think,
Yeah, in the explosion. Yeah. And then the train, like, comes, but right before the train comes, he, like, says something to Batman, and then when the train, like, passes, he's gone on a motorcycle. And since then later they're back in the Batcave and they're reviewing the film.
Alfred's patch up Nightwing and Bruce listening to the recording. I mean, they're watching the footage and they're commenting.
And that's giving us the play-by-play of what this guy's doing. And basically saying, like, how impressive that move where he cut the rope was. Bruce went in, or Batman's even more, like, impressed than Nightwing, I think. Because he's like, you know, not even too many knives can, like, cut my ropes and stuff, so... had to be, like, an impressive, you know, a significant knife as well as, like, the skill to do it. And then also we also see, like, him, like, thinking, and he sees, like, a flashback of Jason Todd. Like, then, like, they're, like, going after the Riddler. And at some point in that fight, Jason Todd does the same move, cutting the rope, like, with a batarang.
It's still quite put together yet.
Yeah, and then there's also, I think that he also sees another flashback then with an older Jason Todd.
When he breaks one guy's car,
and they're taking out some, some
drug house.
And instead of, like, the guy was already defeated, and instead of just, like, capturing him and asking questions, he, like, attacks him and breaks his collarbone and sends him into shock. And basically, Batman's in reprimanding him for this, and he's like, you know,
right.
you can see how much of, I guess, more aggressive Jason Todd is. And more of a temper and stuff. So they're showing you kind of his character throughout these things. And Batman remembering being with Jason Todd. It's like these seeds are being planted kind of in Batman's mind kind of throughout the movie. Then Nightwing leaves because he's hurt.
After Nightwing leaves, it's going through the recording. He's going back right when the train cuts him off from the Red Hood, and he hears Red Hood say something, and he isolates the audio, and he hears, basically he finally gets it clear enough to where he can hear Red Hood go, you haven't lost your touch, Bruce.
Yeah, and then he freaks out even more.
Yeah, because he realizes that whoever this is knows his true identity.
Yeah, which is pretty huge for Batman. You know, in the real world, in actual movies, you know, everybody knows, and it's not that big of a deal. But, you know, in real Batman stories, it's a big deal.
Yeah.
I mean, it's like the people he's involved with, like, through history, there's not too many people that find out who Batman is. Maybe in, like, isolated stories, maybe. But for the most part, it's like all the people he's around, like, you know, Alfred, Nightwing, Batgirl, all those people. And then the only other ones really are, you know, eventually Commissioner Gordon, but not even in the traditional stories.
Yeah, a lot of them, yeah.
And also eventually Catwoman in some of the stories.
Sure.
You know, and then the only other ones really are Ra's al Ghul, Bane,
and Hugo Strange.
Right. Yeah. And those are the only ones I can really think of that.
Yeah. And those are big moments when it happens, you know. But
Ra's al Ghul's, he more kind of always knew. But he's really the only one.
Yeah. Bane and Hugo Strange are, like, the only ones to, like, figure it out among the villains, you know.
Yeah. So then it goes to Black Mask in his place. Now he's even more mad because now he just took down another whole shipment that he has. You know, he's freaking out and punching out, like, all of his guards and everything. Eventually he's like, no, I need, you know, this guy needs to be dead. You know, I need him dead and mounted on my wall. And, like, all these, you know. And then he, like, turns and is, like, facing the window. And all of a sudden, you just see this, like, light, like on his head and stuff. And then he just looks up and he's like, oh, hell. And you just see, Red Hood with, like, a bazooka, like, waving at him.
He fires it.
And it, you know, blows up in the thing. And I think they, like, run, you know, Black Mask and all of them are, like, bolting out of the room. And it, like, lands and explodes the room. And so then, like, Black Mask is sitting there and, you know, fire everywhere. And he's like, you know, he's now driven me to, like, a place that I don't want to go. He's like, I now have to, you know, talk to someone who I don't want to. And then you see that he, And then there's a scene in Arkham, and Joker basically is broken out of Arkham by guards paid off by Black Mask. Yeah. And then he arranges a meeting with him, and that's another good scene. And so it's Joker sitting there. It's probably like 5 or 6 guards, like, all around, and then Black Mask and his, like, assistant. And so he's basically here telling him his problem with Red Hood. Joker's just sitting there eating potato chips the whole time. And after he, like, finishes, he's like, I need your help, you know, we'll provide you with whatever you need and all this stuff. He's just like, can I have some water?
May I have some water? I'm going to need something to wear in a very big truck.
Sure. Anything else?
I'll need some guys. Not these guys, because, well, they're kind of dead.
He didn't even need to do that. He was just did it because he wanted to. And
he wanted to be on his terms, yeah.
Yeah, and so he's like, so I'll need, like, I think he says, like, I'll need a truck and, like, a couple other things. And then he's like, I need some guys. He's like, not these guys, because they're kind of dead.
Yeah, I mean, classic Joker. I mean, dear, I need a glass of water. Like, oh, God. You know, it harkens back to the, I just want my phone call. You're like, oh, that's all I want. You love it when that happens.
Yeah, it's classic Joker. It's great. It's great. It's predictable, but great.
Yeah, if you know the Joker, as soon as he asks for something, like, don't give it to him.
he almost, although sometimes he does ask for stuff literally just because he wants them, though.
Sure. And
which,
that's part of the Joker.
Which is the great thing with the Joker.
Yeah.
Never know.
Then it goes to, like, the guys working for Red Hood corner, the one mob boss who hasn't, like, turned over yet. And that's when the... they have the Molotov cocktail, and they're about to throw it in the
car. Oh, no, it's
the
other way around. That's the guys for Red Hood. They're Black Mask guys.
Yeah, they're working for Black Mask. They're trying to intimidate the guy to, you know, go against the Red Hood. And they're about to, you know, fire this car, and freaking the Red Hood shoots a bullet at the Molotov cocktail. It explodes, and the guy catches on fire. I mean, a horrific scene.
Yeah.
And then, like, you know, he comes down. I forget what else he does, but, yeah.
Well, and then... he, like, takes out that guy, because they're, like, send him Red Hood a message and all this stuff, and he's like, what's the message?
Yeah.
Then the guy runs off, and then the four, like, assassins show up.
Yeah.
They each have, like, special, like, there's, like, a girl with swords, a guy with, like, this staff, and then this other, like, big guy, and then, like, a weird-looking thing with a face blaster. I don't know. It's strange.
Again, kind of weird with the whole Batman setting, but, I mean, yeah, they're, like, some... assassin team, they're like high-tech ninjas basically.
Yeah.
And so yeah, they start fighting the Red Hood. He holds his own for most of it because he's pretty trained.
He just kind of gets beaten down eventually, and then they're like,
yeah,
well, we thought you would have put up more of a fight. He's like, oh, you know, I'm just stalling. I'm like, stalling for what? And then Batman shows up, and then he starts to fight with the Red Hood against these guys, which is another pretty cool fight. All the fight scenes in this movie are really good.
Yeah.
And they're fighting back and forth, and then at one point the Red Hood gets, like, cut with one of the girl's swords, and then they end up knocking out all of them, and then the weird face
laser
guy like has, like, I think he has Batman down and is about to, like, blast him, and then Red Hood, like, hits him, and then he ends up, like, grabbing Red Hood and, like, has him. And And then, like, but before he can do anything, Red Hood, like, pulls out a taser and, like, shoves it in his face, and his head blows up for some reason.
Yeah, it explodes. Definitely kills him. So bad.
It definitely kills him.
Yeah.
Another pretty gruesome scene in the movie. You just, they're like, the camera just pans up, and you just see blood just, like, splatter against the wall.
Yeah, you hear him scream, and, I mean, you definitely get the idea of what happens.
Yeah.
And, so Batman freaks out.
And then Red Hood's, like, quick to be like, you better be lucky I didn't kill all of them.
Mm-hmm.
And then he's basically saying, like, you know, your brand of this brand of crime fighting doesn't work anymore. Like, you can't stop crime. Like, it's impossible. So instead of stopping crime, he's basically saying, like, I'm controlling it by controlling the mob and controlling the drug trade and everything. Because another thing he said when he first talked to them was, like, no dealing to children.
Right.
You know, and stuff like that. So he's like, you know, it's never going to go away. So I'm basically monitoring crime.
Yeah. And it's a good point. I mean, you kind of go, yeah, I mean, obviously we all always side with Batman, but it's like, you know, it's always been kind of one of Batman's greatest dilemmas. Like, yeah, what happens? Obviously one day Batman's either going to die or get too old, but crime's still going to be around. So, and that's, I love it when movies touch on that.
Yeah, and also just the whole factor of him not killing. He's like, you know, why not? He's like, you know, people don't respond to you nearly as much as they respond to me.
It's straight out season two of Daredevil when the Punisher is like, you hit them and they get back up. I hit them and they stay down. And it's great. I love when that's some of the best, you know, dilemmas in superhero stories when they talk about that. Mm-hmm. And that conflicting ideology.
I think it's done really well in that scene. And then Red Hood throws like a smoke bomb or something and then disappears, a la Batman. And, which is always great. I always love when that happens to Batman.
That's the Batman, yeah.
It's just funny. And then he sees the sword with Red Hood's blood on it. So at this point, he already kind of suspects that this is Jason Todd.
Well, he knows that, obviously, it's someone he knows.
I think he already suspects Jason Todd because you see him flashing back in his mind from Jason Todd.
I guess that's what the movie's implying, but you really don't. I didn't really get that until, I mean, of course, he goes back to the Batcave, he scans the blood, and then it shows as Jason Todd. And so, you know, Alfred freaks out. He's in shock, and so is Bruce. And it's like.
Well, Bruce doesn't freak out as much. He's more just like. Because he already kind of suspected it, but he's trying to figure out how.
Yeah.
Yeah. And so then they go and dig up the grave, and then it's another stupid scene. They open the thing, and then it's just like a fully intact body in there, and then Alfred's like, see, he's still there. It's like, no, the body wouldn't be fully intact like this if it was real. So yeah, it's pretty obvious that this is not the actual body, and Alfred's like acting like, oh, see, there he is. It's like,
yeah.
No, as soon as you see that, you would know that that's not real, because it would have decayed significantly.
So he frames it, and it's like a latex dummy or something.
And then he knows that it's Ra's al Ghul, because he was the one involved in it in the first place. He goes to Ra's al Ghul's palace and confronts him about it, and then he basically tells him the whole story of after he was...
Flashback.
Yeah, because he felt... Because he did the same thing kind of Black Mask did. He enlisted the Joker to help be a distraction for him while he was doing some of his, you know, eco-terrorist thing. But he underestimated his ability to control the Joker, as everybody does, which everybody's stupid, I guess.
Yeah.
And then, he didn't anticipate Joker kidnapping Jason Todd and killing him. So then he felt guilty about it.
Mm-hmm.
And so then tried to see what he could do, use the Lazarus Pit, basically like as an experiment to see if it would even bring people back from the dead.
Ra's al Ghul switches out the bodies at the morgue, so Bruce takes back the dummy, and then he feels guilty, and then feel guilty, he tries to bring Jason Todd back to life using the Lazarus Pit, which he never really tried. It's always, you know, when he's really, really old, he goes into it and comes back younger. So they try doing it with a dead body, and then they see what happens, you know.
Yeah. He comes back, but, like, mentally, like, insane, and...
Mm-hmm.
Freaks out and then jumps out of the window like off like the cliff and it's just
kills like a priest, you know, like he gouges their eyes out. Really dark scene. It's like, you know, it's almost like a Dr. Jekyll, Mr. Hyde, the way he's, you know, screaming and he has no idea what's going on and he just runs away and jumps off a cliff and obviously Ra's thinks he's dead and he talks about how they searched for the body but never found one.
And then Batman's mad at himself for not realizing that this happened, which Ra's says, he's like, I counted on you being so distraught, you wouldn't even check a body. And I like how they mention, I like how they even touch on that, because otherwise you're like, how in the world would Batman not know? They cover the bases there. And and so then now he knows that that's Jason Todd, like, you know, now he's for sure. Yeah. And so then he goes back to Gotham, almost like confronts him. And then, of course, at this point, the Joker has completely done away with Black Mask, and he's now sitting there in the middle of a bridge with the truck that he asked for, and all of the people, both from the Red Hood's now like mob, and Black Mask, and all of his people in the truck, tied up. And Black Mask just like, you can't trust anyone. It's like, no, duh. It's the Joker.
Yeah, and all the cops are there. They have it surrounded, and Joker's on top. They get a big show of it, and then he starts pouring gasoline into the truck.
Yeah.
And, of course, you know what he's going to do.
And then Red Hood shows up, and he's, like, trying to light the lighter, and it's not working. And he's like, hold on. I'm in the middle of setting fire to your gang. He goes, that's fine. I think I care if, you know, they die? He's like, I just wanted what I really wanted was an audience with you. And then Joker, like, stops and it's like, what? You act like you arranged this little meeting. And he's like, mm-hmm. I did. It took a lot of, you know, a lot of effort getting Black Mask desperate enough to break you out, because I knew he was the only one with connections to do that. And he's like, and then Joker's just like, wow. So I've been bamboozled. And then he's like disappointed. He's like, man, mm-hmm. you know, because he's been played basically.
Yeah.
And he's basically saying like, you know, I wanted this to, you know, to meet with you again. And Joker's like, again. He's like, if we met. Mm-hmm. And he's like, oh yeah. And then like, you know, in the middle of this, he like finally gets the thing to light and then drops it down. But then like as soon as like it drops, then Batman like shows up and puts it out. And then, you know, he grabs the Joker with like a claw or something and is taking him away. But then Red Hood jumps and grabs on and cuts the rope. Then they fall into the water and then are mm-hmm. gone. And then, basically he gets like a message from Red Hood saying like, which is pretty vague. And the fact that he just, you know, but anyway, Batman shows up. In like an alley, and then you get like a little flashback of him, like when he first meets Jason Todd, when he shows up and the Batmobile's up on blocks and all the tires have been taken, which is just a great origin of Jason Todd, and then Jason, you know, Red Hood's there and is like, you know, they start fighting, which is another great fight,
yeah.
And they end up like on a roof somewhere, and
which I noticed. Did you notice how it was a lot like the ending to The Crow, where they're on top of the cathedral and it's like raining, and they're like, you know, fighting the gargoyles stuff. It looked exactly like a showdown in The Crow, which I thought was kind of cool.
Yeah, kind of. I can see that. Mm-hmm. And then he unmasks Batman, which it just seems preposterous to me. You can just like reach out, pop. Well, then why haven't anybody else done that? I feel like in every fight, that can just easily be done.
You think, yeah. I forget specifically how he does it, but yeah.
No, he literally, they're just, like, fighting like this, and then he just, like, reaches over and, like, pulls the mask off.
Oh, shit.
Yeah, it's pretty simple. And then he's sitting there, and he's like, well, that's even the odds. And he takes his mask off, and it's Jason Todd.
Mm-hmm.
Which is a cool shot of him, like, standing there, and then when the lightning strikes, it, like, briefly flashes of him in the Robin suit, which is pretty cool.
Yeah.
I'm a sucker for those type of shots. I think they look cool.
Yeah.
Batman ends up like, you know, setting fire like his jacket with all his like stuff on it, and and then
the mask turns into a bomb and blows.
Yeah. The mask blows up, and then they end up fighting like going like inside the building, and they're fighting like in a bathroom. And
yeah, like the Red Hood jumps into the building, abandoned building, and so is Batman, and then they have the really brutal fight in the bathroom with Batman.
Nobody bleeds.
Yeah. They're
getting their faces smashed into the toilet and the side of the tub, and they're just not bruised or nothing.
Mm-hmm.
Pretty nice to be a cartoon.
Right.
Then they, like, smash into a room.
And then he pulls the gun on him. To kind of end it, because this game is asking, basically.
Yeah, because it's Batman. And, so then Jason Todd pulls a gun on Bruce, and he's, like, basically talking to him, you know, about, you know, all this stuff. And then Batman's, like, you know, apologizing to him for, you know, not being there in time and letting him die. And Jason is like, no, you don't understand. He's like, I forgive you for all of that. Like,
mm-hmm.
you know, that's like, the line of duty. Like, I signed up for that. He's like, you know, I don't hold you responsible for that. He's like, but why on earth is he still alive? And he, like, breaks down the door, and it's a Joker sitting there. This whole scene is just great for the Joker. It's just so well done.
It's great, period, because, and that's what I'm saying, like, you know, if you hadn't read the book or know what happens, it's like, this is a really good scene, because just the fact that he mentions, you know, I don't blame you for not seeing me in time. He's like, I get that, you know, that was out of your control, but the fact that you didn't come back and avenge me, by killing the Joker, and the fact that you left him alive, despite what he did to me, you didn't make sure he couldn't do it to anyone else, is why he, you know, basically, you know, is against Batman. I think that's really interesting, really, really good.
Yeah, and they basically pull that scene from the book, almost word for word, from the comic, like that whole thing. Mm. Basically, he's just like, you know, everything that this guy's done, you know, the thousands of people he's killed, like, why is he, you know, dead? Why is it, like, so hard for you to kill him? And he's like, no, it's not too hard. It'd be too easy. It's like, there's not a day goes by I don't think of killing him. And then Joker's just like, oh, so you do think about me.
Yeah. Just being, you know, annoying as shit the whole time. You know,
the whole time. Like, when he first shows him, he's just like, oh, so it's a party. This is great. We get everyone here. All right, who's got a camera? First, get me one of me and the bat. Then one of me and the kid. Then one with the crowbar. And then
great, yeah.
And so Batman's saying, you know, all I've ever wanted to do is kill him.
Right.
But I know, like, once I go over that, like, you know, there's no going back after that. And then Jason Todd's basically saying, like, what we all think. And it's like, what? No, no, I'm not saying... talking about killing any of your other villains. He's like, we're not talking about, you know, Penguin or Two-Face or any of these people. He's like, just him, because of just how much he's done and because he took me away from you. I mean, and it's a fair point, you know.
Yeah, it you know, it kind of ties over right into the Killing Joke, you know, the ending of the Killing Joke, where it's like, what does Batman do? I mean, because I do agree with Batman that, you know, it's the whole point of him being a hero is that he doesn't decide himself who gets to live and who dies, because then he just becomes a vigilante, becomes an executioner. But at a certain point, you go, in terms of safety, just killing the Joker to keep people safe, because, yeah, he harms the most people, unlike, you know, even compared to people like Penguin and Two-Face.
Well, because they're criminals. That's the difference. Yeah. Those other ones are criminals with, you know, goals or whatever, but like running, you know, taking over. So, and the Joker is none of that. It's literally just to cause pain.
Yeah.
Like, so that's, like, that's the inherent difference between Joker and all these other guys. But then there's Batman saying, like, but once, like, you, once I do that, once I become a killer, it's, I'm, you know, you're always that. You can't just do it off and on.
Yeah.
It's, you know, you either are or you aren't.
Yeah, because also then, in a way, he's undermining Gordon and the police, where, you know, there's already kind of that struggle of, oh, well, does, you know, Gotham really need the police if Batman's doing their job? And if he kind of turns around and goes behind their back and starts killing people and is like, well, I'm going to do my own brand of justice, you know, Gordon can really, you know, be on his side with that, where he's like, because then he's a, yeah, he's a vigilante.
Yeah.
So it, as painful as it is, I always agree with Batman in that regard. That's why it's my favorite.
Yeah. Yeah, so it's just, it's a great thing that's brought up a lot, and it's just done so well in here.
Yeah.
So basically, you know, Batman saying, you know, I can't do this. It's like, I can't do it. And then, so he's, you know, now Jason Todd's all, you know, really getting mad. And he's like, well, you won't have a choice.
Yeah.
And he's like, you know, you either kill me or I'm going to kill him. And this is the dumbest part of the entire movie.
Oh, okay.
It makes absolutely no sense. The way they do it in the movie. In the book, which I have the book here, it's done a little bit differently. So in the movie... in the movie, he's saying, he throws Batman a gun, and he's like, you know, you're either going to kill me or I'm going to kill the Joker.
Right.
And then Batman's, and he's like, you know, you have to decide. It's either him or me.
Mm-hmm.
And Batman's walking away. He's like, all right, go ahead and kill him. He's just walking, he's leaving. And Jason and I keep screaming, decide, me or him, decide. And Batman's just like leaving. He's like, okay, he decided, go ahead and kill him.
Yeah.
But then he's like, ah, and then he like goes to shoot Batman.
Oh, okay. So you're mad that Jason doesn't just go ahead and kill him.
Right. What does he want him to do? Batman's like, all right, go ahead and kill him.
Yeah, because that's the part I love, is where he throws Batman a gun and you think, you know, this is going to be Batman, but he drops, he's like, nope.
And like, and then he's not even saying, like, you kill the Joker or I'm going to kill you. Or no, he's like, you kill me or I'll kill the Joker. And so he's just leaving. So he's like, all right, go ahead and kill the Joker.
Yeah. Because at that point, Batman is kind of like, obviously, I failed you. You're not Jason Todd. You become the Red Hood. So, yeah, he turns his back on him. He's like, if you kill a Joker, I can't stop you.
Yeah, he's like, go ahead. And then Jason, for some reason, still freaks out. And then it's like going to go shoot Batman. None of this makes sense.
Yeah, the whole part where he doesn't kill a Joker and then tries to kill Batman. And, of course, Batman, like a badass, you know.
Yeah.
Here's a hammer, throws a Batarang, blows with a gun. But, yeah.
Sure, it's a cool little moment, but that whole thing makes no sense whatsoever. In the book, it's still a little dumb, but it makes more sense.
Sure.
In the book, he's asking, it's him or me. It's that whole thing. You know, he has the gun on the Joker, and it's like, you have to either kill me or I'm going to kill him. And he's like, I'll count to three. And then Batman the whole time is like, put down the gun. You know, like, stop doing this. And he's like, you know, one, two. And Batman's like, don't. And then, you know, and then he's about to say three. And Batman's like, says no. And that's when he throws the batarang.
Okay.
And he bounces it off of the wall. And then it hits Jason Todd, making him drop the gun, which makes so much more sense.
Yeah.
Like, why didn't they just do that? Like, why?
Or it could be interesting where if Jason Todd were really, like, you know, crazy and stuff, he would put the gun to his head and be like, either you kill the Joker or I'm going to kill myself. That means you let me die twice. Because that would be a lot more like, then it would be a lot more like he had to do something.
Yeah, if you were going to change it, do that. But in the book, it at least makes sense. I still think it doesn't make sense why he really doesn't want the Joker killed.
Yeah.
Why? Okay, if you can't kill the Joker, go ahead. Like, I don't see why that would be a problem.
I guess to keep the Joker alive for whatever, you know, continuation that was from, but yeah.
I don't know. None of that. None of this whole thing, even the one in the book, doesn't really make a lot of sense, but at least this one makes some sort of logical sense. Because it's actually, you know, he's like, I'm going to kill him. One, two, and then Batman, you know, is like, no, and to stop him. And then it's when he's like, I'm going to kill him. I'm going to kill him. Batman just turns.
I just like how Batman doesn't have to decide. He's like, nope. He's like, you're not going to make me. And he's like, I can't help you then. But yeah, the rest of it,
none of that makes sense. But anyway, once he blows up the gun, then the Joker's now free. And then Joker's like,
I can't believe you got him. You expert rootin' tootin' eagle-eyed goth-loving marksman. I love it. You managed to find a way to win. And everybody still loses! No! Don't spoil it! This is better! I'm the only one who's gonna get what he wants tonight! Yes! Bing, bang, boom! We all go out together! Don't you just love a happy ending?
And then the bomb just blows up with them right next to it, and everyone's fine. And then Jason Todd's still alive, Joker's still alive, and Batman's gone. And all of, basically all that ending, just where it went from, goes from like amazing to stupid to amazing to stupid.
Yeah, well let me ask you about that, because one thing I want to bring up in the review is that there's been a lot of talk that, in terms of the Batman Real movies, this is kind of the next one. It's like an obvious big storyline to do. Because they already kind of did Dark Knight Returns of Batman v Superman. And, of course, in Batman v Superman, where there's an Easter egg of the Dead Robin costume, there's been a lot more talk about, oh, well, clearly they want to do the Red Hood storyline. And I've been conflicted about it for multiple reasons. One, I don't have faith in them doing it in the current line. But also, I just kind of wonder, how much more can you bring to a movie, you know, when you already know the big twist and the ending is kind of anticlimactic like that? So I kind of wanted to get your take.
As far as doing it, I'd be really happy in a way, because I think the story's awesome. So just seeing it done would be cool. But again, I would be disappointed because I already have zero faith, as you do.
Right.
And as far as it already being done, is like, yeah, the twist is already... For a general movie audience won't know.
Sure.
Obviously, all the comic fans will know. But what worries me most of all is because of that, they'd change it.
Mm-hmm.
They would just change the story to be something totally
different. Yeah, like maybe they would change it, maybe to make it more impactful, like the Red Hood dies or something, which, I don't know, it could be. I think that could be really impactful Batman isn't able to save him again.
Yeah.
And,
I mean, and I'd be fine with that, to be honest.
I would too.
As far as the change goes, I think it could be done. It definitely seems to be set up, enough.
Well, here's the biggest problem, though. In this universe, you know, they obviously show that the Joker killed Robin, and the biggest problem is that they already established that Batman snapped after that, you know, in the events leading up to his altercation with Superman, and that he's killing people. And that defeats the whole purpose of the story, whereas if he snapped and started killing normal people, the first thing that he would do is walk into Arkham, if that's where the Joker was, and just break his neck. Because I'd be the first person he'd kill if he's like, fuck it, you know, my code is done and all that stuff. And yeah, so I mean, that's obviously the biggest reason that they can't, but I'm sure they haven't even thought about that.
Oh yeah, I'm sure they haven't even thought of it. But yeah. I think we have talked about that. Yeah, I agree with that. That doesn't really make any sense. The only way that could possibly make sense is if if the Joker disappeared.
And that's what they would have.
Which is possible, but then sure. Like they've already shown like this other scene with Batman and the Joker from Suicide Squad.
Exactly.
So I don't know, maybe if that was before, that could have been before.
They'll say that, yeah.
Oh, but that's where he captures Harley Quinn, so
yeah.
And it says that she's an accomplice to the death of Robin in the Suicide Squad credits. So, yeah, that's a whole nother can of worms that would have to be sorted through. And to be honest, I don't even think they'd bother sorting through it.
Nope.
At this point, I think they just make that happen. And,
yeah.
You know, hope the audience is as dumb as they've hoped it's been since the beginning.
Yeah. But the anime movie is still really good. I mean, beside the, again, lackluster ending.
But, yeah, because, like, the ending of the book... it's even more open-ended than the movie. Like, it literally ends with the explosion and then, like, Batman screaming Jason. And that's literally the last panel. And the last title, like, of the internal monologue on the last panel says, "We've been here before."
Mm-hmm.
And it's him yelling Jason. So the book implies that he dies.
Yeah.
But then obviously he doesn't because he becomes a character in comics.
Right.
So that's a little bit confusing. But,
and this one ends with a little flashback of, you know, like the very first time Robin puts on the suit,
yeah.
And it's like a happy moment.
Yeah.
And it kind of hammers that kind of sadness of it all. That yeah, he remembers Jason as this, you know, optimistic little kid, and then he sees kind of how he has failed him. Where now he has this negative look on everything. Where yeah, he's become a vigilante, and he thinks that the only way to save Gotham is by either killing criminals or controlling crime. Yeah, so it is still sad.
So there's a couple of parts that are dumb. The ending, unfortunately, goes from really, really good to really stupid really fast, which is really disappointing. But overall, the movie, I think, is very strong. It's very well done. The voice acting, I think, is really good. The animation was very good. The action was great. I thought all of the action scenes were really well done and entertaining.
And it deserved its rating, where I feel like the only reason they made... like, you know, they made the Killing Joke R and it was a big deal, but really didn't need to. And like it tried to be a lot more controversial, you know, obviously the sex scene and then the violence, but like this is a movie where it's mature and still be, you know, a step forward from like most of the source material animated stuff. But it does it in a way that, you know, in scenes that needs to, where the scene where Jason Todd comes back to life is really dark and the scene where the guy has his head blown off is really dark, but you know it doesn't throw in random stuff that just to be risque.
Yeah, it everything's natural in it.
Yeah,
and so it's literally like they made the movie the way it should have been, and then the rating came from whatever.
Which is how it should be. Yeah.
You know, who cares what the rating is? We're gonna make the movie the way we think it should be made, and then you know whatever the rating is, it is. That's the way it feels. Everything feels naturally made, and you know all the scenes and. I think it goes together well. I think the flow of the movie is pretty good. The action mixed with, you know, the exposition, I feel like it's separated really well.
Yeah.
I think the runtime's probably like minute, you know, an hour 10, something like that. Most animated movies are right around like 70 minutes or so.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
You know, it's not too long. I think it does justice to the source material for the most part.
I agree.
Overall, I like it. It's got a couple of – I really like it, actually. I think it's a great movie. A couple of problems, the ending a little bit, but overall, it's a great story.
Yeah.
I highly recommend reading it if you haven't. The book is definitely better. It's more in depth, obviously. But overall, very, very good movie.
Yeah.
And it was so good, it sparked, you know, the past, I think, like 10 or 11 animated movies that have come out since 2010 when that movie did.
Yeah.
So we've had like 11 animated Batman movies in like 6 years so far.
Yeah.
Which is, you know, pretty good. It always is that first one. If that first one's good, then it sparks the rest of them.
Yeah, and again, it just, you know, reminds people of all the good, great storylines of Batman comics. So then, you know, they want to read the other ones that are famous, you know, Death in the Family and stuff like that. And, And that's why now comic book sales are like at an all-time high, apparently. Because, yeah, movies like this where, like, you know, your normal audience knows who Batman is, but they don't know the specific, you know, stories that are, you know, legendary in the comic world. And so that's why movies like this are great.
Yeah, we'll see if they, you know, what they pick to do maybe for the next one. I know, obviously, they're doing the Batman 66 movie next, which is going to be amazing. And then they're doing, I feel like they announced, like, Batman and Harley Quinn being, like, the title of one of the next animated movies
next year. Kevin Conroy and Mark Hamill spoke out and they wanted to do Under the Red Hood, but I mean, which would be awesome hearing them, but at this point, again,
they've already done it.
Yeah, exactly. That's the problem. And again, like I said, how many different ways can you do this story and like what new can you bring to it? Even though it would be great hearing them do it, this one is, to me, doesn't need to be redone.
No, I don't think it does. I think it's very accurate to the material and doesn't really need any updating.
No.
We'll see what they really do, you know, with the further animated movies. But yeah, that's pretty much it. So, any final thoughts with it?
No, I mean, if you haven't seen it, see it. I would see it before you read the comic. But yeah, it's a great animated movie. Definitely see it if you're a fan of Batman. All
right. Well, that's it for this episode of Uncaped Crusaders Review. I'm Mark.
I'm Ian.
And we'll see you guys next time.